Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Awards Watch Oscar podcast. This is podcast number 31, and I am your host, Eric Anderson. And today I've got a couple of Gold Rush gang members we haven't had on for a while. We have Kenneth and Evan. Hello, boys.
Hello. Thanks for having us today.
Hello.
Hello. So, Evan and Kenneth are generally and pretty consistently in the top three, top five of the Gold Rush contest. So it's really, really great to have these guys here. Let's go ahead and get right to it because we have a lot to talk about. There is so much happening. So much has already happened. And next week is the real kickoff of award season. So what did we have this week? We had a joy screening last night in LA and New York. We have The Revenant to screen. I saw it last night, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then next week is the National Board of Review and New York Film Critics. And tomorrow it is also the Gotham Awards, which stream online if you want to watch those. Gosh, what should we start with? Let's kind of start really right off the bat with Joy, because I think it's the thing that has been on everybody's mind of what it's going to be, what its impact is. We at Awards Watch have been very, very bullish about it. And so the response to it is kind of important in that sense. It's definitely important to know where we feel like it's going to land in the race, but also we've put a lot of chips into it. Me mostly, I'll say that, but still, in general. So I think the response was pretty positive, but I don't want to say reserved. There were a couple of people that just flat out didn't like it. But there were interesting revelations of cameos, interesting information about some screen time. But I'm going to throw to you what you guys think from the response that you read. What is it going to do to the race? Kenneth, we'll start with you.
I think like the story of yesterday's screening was almost like, I don't want to say the non-response, but almost how it just, the enthusiasm was very muted, I thought, whether negative or positive. It seemed just kind of, it happened, and people just, I would imagine when a screening this big happens, finally, that there would be a lot more reaction, and there kind of wasn't, and I thought that was really the story. Whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know, and I think that's really where we are right now, is basically where we were yesterday as well, that it happened, but there isn't really much to go on still.
So what do you think about it in comparison to like when American Hustle screened, and it was kind of also a sort of mix between muted and a lot of dislike?
Well, I think that probably bodes well for Joy in that case, just because American Hustle obviously did really well. But Joy, we have to wait for actual reviews. I don't really know what to make of this, to be honest.
Yeah. And I think it's really difficult to try to make any conclusions from these reactions, mainly because there were so few, and they really were, you know, outside of one or two pundits that went into detail, not much detail from anybody else or, you know, a larger group. So it's difficult to really get a read on it. And I hesitate to say that the reaction was muted or that it wasn't muted. I mean, from what I've seen, it was generally very positive.
I agree with that.
It's difficult to, you know, which is also frustrating for us that, you know, we can't kind of box it in somewhere at the moment, you know, but obviously no reason to, you know, do anything, you know, rash, you know, as a result. But as far as the American Hustle thing, I do remember that to be true with regards to the reaction when it screened. And I just kind of wonder if maybe like, obviously I haven't seen Joy, but I wonder if like if the tone is similar to American Hustle, that maybe that's just like a little bit of a blind spot for pundits. They don't know how to like read the tone of these movies and assume that it won't play well with, you know, larger groups of people like the Academy. Mm-hmm. But that's just a sense that I got, is maybe his like kind of tone and tempo maybe are a little out of step in, you know, that they, because I remember that was, that kind of was the story of the American Hustle screening, was like, this is kind of all over the place, you know.
Right. But I mean, but if the tone and tempo is similar to American Hustle and his previous films, I think, again, that bodes well for the film, because clearly the Academy likes what he's doing, and there's an audience for his movies there, which the pundits don't necessarily really see in the same way, which is, you know.
Yeah, the only person that I read that had a problem with the tone was Gregory Elwood, but everybody else seemed really completely into it. And then those comments that we had heard from the test screenings of, you know, similarities to things like The Godfather and Citizen Kane, they're there.
Yeah.
So that's good.
Yeah, I think all signs still point to it being, you know, obviously a major contender, as, you know, as Awards Watch was predicting for much of the year.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I don't think we'll get any kind of resolution otherwise, or any kind, you know, any movement in that direction until we actually get, you know, reviews from critics and see what people are actually thinking about it, you know, so, which won't be, I believe, until the 14th of December.
14th, yeah. I'm seeing it next Thursday, and I'll have to bite my lip as much as I possibly can. But do you guys think, though, will it need critic support and approval in terms of, you know, actual like critics awards to be able to make it a contender, or do you think that it can just be one on its own?
I don't think it needs critics awards to be a contender, but I guess it depends on what you mean as a contender. Like, you know, do you mean like a contender to win major Oscars? Is that what
you're... Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, got it.
Yeah.
I don't really think it needs that, needs major critics awards, and I'm not really anticipating that it'll get them. Of course, no one was anticipating that American Hustle was going to get those big wins from the New York Film Critics, which kind of really... you know, blew it up in a big way.
Yeah.
You know, before, you know, at that point, people were starting to second guess whether it would even be a major contender. And then, of course, it won these awards, and that kind of changed everything. I don't think it actually needs to win any critics' awards. I do think it generally needs, you know, obviously needs like some, you know, general critical acclaim and whatnot. Just because the expectations are so high.
Yeah, I definitely agree there.
I think that's really the case. I don't think it needs critics' awards. I think that we're looking... I mean, the season kind of almost plays in two parts for me these days. It's like we have the first section with all the critics' awards and the Golden Globes, and then everything kind of resets with when the industry starts to chime in, and as we saw last year, where like the dynamic of the race completely changed once the PGA announced.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that that's where Joy really needs to do well if it wants to become... a front runner to win Best Picture. If it does well with the industry, then it'll be a contender to actually win. I don't think it needs critics awards. It does need good reviews, obviously, to not be seen as a disappointment.
And it'll surely have good box office too, which will help. Like,
yeah, I agree. Well, speaking of the industry contingent of this, this is something that we see and struggle with every year, are these end of December releases that don't get screened in time or don't get screeners out in time to the nominating committee. And certainly Joy is susceptible to that. It's looking like it's mostly going to depend on these screenings and Q&As to get it there, whereas plenty of other films already have their screeners out, and you know the Screen Actors Guild deadline is the 7th, so it's just barely a week away. So it's something like this feels like it's already so far behind, but the nominating committee is only like 2,000 people, I think, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if they have enough Q&As, I imagine they could get the votes that they needed. I don't know.
Yeah.
Does it seem like it?
I don't know. I mean, you know, the common line of thinking is that you need screeners for like the screen, you know, to the, you need to send screeners to the SOG nominating committee in order to get nominated, and I don't know what the status is of Joy Screeners, if they're, you know, I don't know what their plan is, if they're, you know, planning to try to get them out in the next week or something, or if that's even possible, depending on when the film, you know, when the film was finished.
Yeah, exactly. It's not even effectively finished right now. Still.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Which is insane. But it's
true. So that
makes
clearly
me nervous.
It clearly does not seem that it will have screeners in time for the SAG nominating committee, especially considering voting, I believe, ends at like noon Pacific time on December 7th, mm-hmm. is when voting closes.
Yeah.
I still imagine that, and I've been thinking this for a while before the screening, and I still think the same thing, that with SAG, Joy is probably safest in its most sort of safest categories, which is Ensemble and Jennifer Lawrence, which was similar to American Hustle.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think that even as it stands now, it could still get those two nominations. The supporting cast, that is really where the main questions for Joy lie, really, is who in the supporting cast is actually a standout enough, if any of them, to actually receive any nominations anywhere, period.
Yeah.
And from what I'm still kind of, the tidbits that we're getting, it seems like to me that this really is the Jennifer Lawrence show, this movie, much more so than any of his previous films, at least with her.
It does, and anything that we were kind of like trying to grab onto for supporting nominations is just kind of, I mean, we're hearing that Robert De Niro is great in the first third and then doesn't have much to do in the rest. And right. We're seeing Isabella Rossellini everywhere, not as much Diane Ladd. But then...
Even though Diane Ladd will be at a SAG screening tomorrow, I believe?
She will be. And then Jeff Wells' comments was how great she was. So yeah. It's... But she has like, what, half a second total in all the trailers and TV spots?
Right.
It's crazy. So we just have so little to go on in terms of supporting. Definitely, I'm with you guys in that this could play out for SAG anyway, the same way that American Hustle did.
Yeah.
I have no doubt about that at this point.
Yeah, where we saw the kind of undeniable, where we saw the film score and kind of like the undeniable locations, like Ensemble and supporting actors, which were definitely the strongest bets for American Hustle at the time. And some of those other categories, you know, it didn't hit just due to the fact of being underseen.
Yeah, and that's why it ended up, you know, being able to score 10 nominations at the Academy Awards, because by that time, you know, it had been seen enough, for sure. Yeah.
And it surely eventually will not suffer, you know, from being underseen. I do think, you know, as we see some, like you were mentioning earlier, how some of these films like Joy or The Revenant or Hateful Eight, where it seems like they have a lot of catching up to do because people have been campaigning and screening their movies for months.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think there is some truth to that in the sense that the race, it does start to solidify, or not necessarily solidify, because obviously these things can change the race, but people's perceptions of it start to solidify, whether true or false. And I think it can be difficult because, you know, to kind of come in here as people start to think about the race in one way or another, that it can become difficult to get in there and get the necessary buzz to change things up. But with that said, obviously, you know, David O. Russell, Jennifer Lawrence collaboration is in another stratosphere in that regard. Like, you know, everyone will see this movie.
Well, that it'll be priority viewing at some point.
Mm-hmm.
So once it gets out there, people will see it. That's without question.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that if it underperforms at SAG, I don't honestly think that really matters.
Right.
It's also his only PG-13 movie, if you don't count Accidental Love.
Hmm.
So I think that is something that bodes really well for it, especially over like the Christmas holiday.
Oh, absolutely.
Mm. Because by then, you know, Academy members will have screeners, and that's certainly, and you know, we talk about this a lot, and so do a lot of pundits, of like, you have a stack of screeners to watch with your family, and what are you going to watch? Are you going to watch, you know, the bone-crunching violence of The Revenant? Are you going to watch, you know, this American story of a female entrepreneur that's PG-13 and probably only has one F-word in it?
Yeah.
That's
true.
That's kind of how you have to think about it. Doesn't mean that it is that way for all AMPUS members, and that's, you know, how they do it. But it's certainly something to think about. So I was really actually surprised when it was revealed that it was going to be PG-13. It certainly seemed like it was kind of going for an angle and a box office that I was just a little surprised.
Yeah.
I feel a little nervous and a little bad for the film in the sense that there's so much expectation that it almost is going to be impossible for it to live up to the trajectory that Russell has had with his last three movies. Each has had more Oscar nominations than the last. Each has had higher box office than the last. So yeah. The expectation for this is almost anything less than, you know, like $150 million and 10 nominations right. is going to be a failure. And that will be the narrative that's written about it, too. So it's almost, it feels inevitable that it's going to fail in that sense.
Yeah. And it's, true. And it's not only, you know, for Russell, it's also for Jennifer Lawrence in a way, because this is the first movie that she's completely carrying on her own name without any kind of franchise or really big ensemble cast that she's a supporting player in or any kind of co-lead. This is really her movie, and so it's also important for her. That's why I'm kind of not surprised that she's out there promoting it much more so than she was American Hustle, for instance.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, and it's I have a really strong feeling that the film is going to do very well and that it will do very well for her. It's been a great year for her in terms of, you know, she's done with Hunger Games and she really is kind of maturing and growing into her own. And then her essay about, you know, gender equality with pay was a huge thing this year.
Right.
It's still part of the conversation. And it's actually something that we can sort of segue into, which has been a part of this Oscar prediction conversation. And that is the amount of female-led movies that we have at this point in the race that are really strong major contenders. But then there's the argument that, you know, in a field of 5 to 10, there can't possibly be 4 female-led movies, or 5 if you include Inside Out, that are going to make it. That the steak eater, meat and potatoes, to use phrases from other pundits, aren't going to go for that. That these old school guys aren't going to care about a chick flick or a woman's movie or something like that. Mm-hmm. And that's a really unfortunate conversation that we are even having to have, but we do have to have it. We have Room, Brooklyn, Carol, and Joy. All sort of competing for the same vote and the same group, despite being very, very different films, obviously. Mm-hmm. So I guess just a direct question to you guys would be, do you think it's even necessary to look at those movies and break them apart as if only one or two can make it in, or can all four make it in?
I think that all four can make it in. I get where the hesitancy to predict what four films that are given the unfortunate label of a women's picture to feel like that all four can't make it in, but I do feel like that these films have kind of established themselves in the race. They have all four have a ton of buzz, and will surely be among the most seen contenders. I don't know. I do have faith, and at the moment I believe. Yeah, at the moment I do have all four in my predicted 9 or whatever best picture nominees, and do feel good about that. And I think they appeal to, you know, I think they do appeal to different segments of voters. And going back to Joy, I do think, for some reason, I don't see Joy the same way, because it almost feels like it's a bigger contender than that, than to be competing with those films. It feels like a bigger deal, if you know what I mean. I don't know if I'm
expressing. Oh, no, I completely 100% agree, because what I feel about Room, Carol, and Brooklyn is that, and as obviously passionate as those films are going to have supporters in, they are still each a pretty niche.
Yeah, Joy, where I think that Joy
is universal.
Yeah, it feels like a bigger, wide, you know, there's a bigger kind of widespread Academy appeal. David O. Russell film, you know, it's a lot of built-in pedigree, and, you know, a lot, you know, kind of a lot of, you know, a big Hollywood element with the cast and, you know, the team behind it, that, I don't know, I feel like it has a much broader appeal, and that to call it, to me, you know, I think to call any of these films women's pictures is, you know, obviously so degrading, but, it, you know, it's what's being said.
Yeah.
But that, you know, that Joy is kind of, does strike me as a, you know, a much bigger deal than some of those films. Although I will, not to go slightly off topic, just one more thing about Joy. Based on yesterday's reactions, I do hope that the Academy finds room to nominate Melissa Rivers for playing Joan Rivers.
Or at least, at the very least, if they get a Saga Ensemble nomination, could she at least be mentioned in that?
God, I hope so. I mean, can we just say that has to be, like, the most shocking thing that came out of the screening, was that is a thing?
That was the true revelation.
And you know that she has a narrative, too, because she played her right after her mother died, so she could talk about how it was a cathartic moment for her to, you know, come to terms and this and that.
Why isn't she on the Q&A? I need to see that. Well, I mean, one of the things about that, and I don't know the context of Melissa Rivers in this exactly, but I have to imagine and maybe hope that it's some of the dream sequence stuff that's still intact.
Right.
Which
right.
I know that's a lot of people were really worried about, because there were two massively different cuts of the film shown in the test screenings, as anybody that listens to us and follows us knows, that really presented two very different films, because Russell was really trying to find the story that he wanted to tell and the tone and all of that. Sight unseen, for me, I'm glad it went that way, because for me, I think his best films and his best storytelling are when he plays with tone and with comedy and drama and surreal elements. My two favorite films of his, Three Kings and Flirting with Disaster, both do that.
Right.
And I think if it can be anywhere even close to that, I'll be overjoyed.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately use a pun that I did not mean to
Any
use.
Any pun intended?
Yeah, that was absolutely unintended. but on back to the women's thing.
Yeah.
Evan, I also have all of those films in. They're in even up to my top eight. Because I still haven't really decided if there's going to be eight or nine this year. I don't know. It seems... You know, every year almost always seems like there could be 10. I mean, it's like, why is there not enough passion for 10 films every year? It seems kind of strange. So I can definitely see them all getting in, because when you're looking at a list of Best Picture nominees, and I have said this before, it's you're looking at a list that has a lot of diversity, and there's not going to be, you know, too many things that seem like they're really similar. And then, of course, as Sasha Stone always brings up, and it's a really, really good point, when people are voting, they're not voting for a top 10, they're voting for a top 5.
Mm-hmm.
That is really, really important to remember. So you can have your 8, 9, 10 stragglers, but they still have to get those number ones. They still have to get in there. That top 5 rule is really important, and something that you just can't dismiss.
And I think that's what I mean, however ineloquently I was putting it, getting at those four films was that it would seem to, I mean, though I think those, you know, I obviously, you know, some pundits, critics, whatever, are labeling them, you know, grouping them together as kind of these women's pictures of the year and thinking, you know, can all four get in, can one, can two. But they're all, you know, having not seen Joy, but having seen Room, Brooklyn, and Carol, they're all, at least those three, are very different movies. And would strike me that they would appeal to different sets of voters. And, you know, I could imagine all three of those films, Carol, Brooklyn, and Room, getting number one votes from different Academy members.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. And I'm just going to pick up on two points that you guys made. Well, Evan said that part of the reason why these films seem so strong is because they obviously have all this buzz. I mean, we're talking about the four movies, the four women's quote-unquote films. And really, that's the thing, is that I couldn't imagine all of them making it right now because all of them have a huge amount of buzz. If we go back to last year, what were the women's pictures? We had Gone Girl, Still Alice, Wild, Big Eyes. None of these films had the same kind of already built-in Best Picture buzz that these films already have, and they just didn't have the same kind of following, nearly, that Room and Brooklyn and Carol and most likely Joy will have.
Yeah,
so I think
absolutely.
That's part of the reason. These films are already a huge part of the race, and you were talking about, Eric, your top eight, and I think there's a very clear top eight at the moment.
I do, too.
If we look at the race.
I do, too.
So, and the other point is about the top five that you were talking about, how people fill out their ballots, and that's where I think something like Inside Out, another quote-unquote woman's film, could suffer in that case, because I don't see it picking up the same amount of number one votes as easily as these other movies, mainly because there is an animated feature category, and I can see a lot of people that love that movie just marking it off over there and calling it a day.
Yeah, I don't think it's getting in either. I don't have it in my top 10. And people will, you know, point to, oh, but Up got in. But they're not remembering that 2009 and 2010 were different voting rules, and it was a solid 10. So it's you can't go to that. Because since then, there hasn't been one.
Right. I mean,
and I think that in addition to that, I do think that when you look back on those years, I mean, maybe Disney has something up its sleeve and we're not seeing it, or you know, they're gonna start campaigning, you know, pretty hard throughout the holiday season. But there was more at this point in the season, a kind of a more pronounced, larger Best Picture push from Disney for both of those films that I just don't really feel like I'm seeing for Inside Out as well.
Absolutely.
And in previous years, I do think that under the current system, things like WALL-E and Ratatouille and Finding Nemo, maybe The Incredibles, probably would have made it in. But again, those felt like much bigger films than Inside Out does at the moment.
Yeah, I'm kind of confused because there are some people that are just like, oh, it's absolutely making it in. There's no way that it's not. And I don't see a strong enough argument for that case.
Yeah,
I see more cases against it than for it.
Yeah.
So I just, yeah.
I guess PGA will be kind of telling if it makes the top 10 there. They also have a preferential ballot. So if it makes it the top 10 there and not just on the animated list, then that'll sort of speak to its chances a little bit better. But
yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it still is an extremely, you know, well-received film that made a ton of money and, you know, obviously had a lot of fans when it was released. Maybe the buzz is just dormant as it sometimes is with the earlier releases. So, you know, I could see, you know, that argument as well.
So,
people are just kind of waiting for that earlier buzz to kind of, you know, build back up again.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not writing it off or anything, but I could see how it would struggle is all I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm writing it off. I mean, just Disney doesn't really care that much. Yeah. They don't campaign. They just kind of let things and their name do the work for them.
So they'll get their animated feature Oscar and then...
Yeah, exactly. Why work any harder?
Yeah.
All right. So, like I said, we have a lot to talk about, and I just realized we're like a half an hour in already. My goodness. Because we've got the National Board of Review coming up. We have the New York Film Critics coming up. So I think it's imperative that we kind of break these down and see what each of us thinks is going to happen. And let's start with the National Board of Review, which is as you know, if you don't know, is not a critics group. They are the oldest organization that gives out film awards. They've been doing it since, I think it's 1909 or something. But they are academics and enthusiasts, but not specifically critics. And we also know their history and their penchant for embracing Warner Brothers films, bad and good alike, as well as anything Clint Eastwood, anything Clint Eastwood. So this year we don't have any Eastwood, thankfully, but we have a lot of Warner Brothers. And I think all of us are expecting the three major Warner Brothers films to make a pretty serious impact. And I think at least some of us might have all three of those films getting into their top 10. Would that be the case for you guys? It is for me. And for the record, those three films are Black Mass, Creed, and Mad Max Fury Road.
Yeah, I have all three. And I mean, I suppose I could see one of them missing, but I think when you're doing your predictions for this group, it's just a lot easier to hedge your bets and just include all their top contenders in, just because most likely that's what will happen.
Yeah, I agree with that, because I think when you look back, I believe, what is it, the last 2 years, WB has gotten three films into the top 10 list.
Yep.
So it's not unusual for them to get, you know, three of their films mentioned, and these are kind of the three that are being buzzed of the moment. I mean, maybe it's unclear how hard WB is pushing Mad Max, but it's still, you know, I think critics are, are kind of keeping it afloat, and there's a lot of still buzz around it. So I think that those are clearly its three, you know, big contenders, and I don't see any reason not to pencil them in for a spot.
And I mean, Creed is obviously pretty late-breaking and just kind of happened in the last week or so, but this is the National Board of Review, and it's going to take one phone call from someone at Warner Brothers to their president, and it's done. So,
well, I mean, clearly, because they've been sleeping on this film, thinking that, you know, maybe it would be like a minor box office hit for them, but it's nobody was expecting the reception that it's gotten, both critically and how strong the box office was, but as well as the serious Oscar talk it's gotten. And so I wonder if Warner Brothers is so behind the ball on this because they put everything into Black Mass. There's like 20 screenings of Black Mass for SAG and DGA and PGA and everything, and there's like four for Creed because they didn't think about it.
Yeah, they didn't anticipate the critics liking it as much as they did, I'm sure.
Yeah, definitely not.
I did kind of wonder, you know, obviously, like you just said, Creed opened to, you know, largely rapturous critical acclaim and, you know, had a great 5 days at the box office as well. But I do agree there was the sense that, like you were saying, that WB was maybe sleeping on it a bit. And as you just mentioned, very few screenings scheduled. I don't think screeners have gone out yet.
No. Nope.
So there is like an element of like they're going to have to play catch up a little bit, I think, with this. With that said, I don't think that, you know, National Board of Review would be an issue. It's never as if there's been one spot reserved for like, you know, a WB film. I think they can get all of them in. And it's important to note that the National Board of Review will be voting on the heels of all of this. So, you know, with headlines for its, you know, for the review, the views for the overall film, the raves for Stallone, the, you know, box office receipts, everything. So I think that it should be, I feel pretty good about penciling it in for one of those spots. When we get later into, you know, SOG and whatnot, I wonder, you know, if it will be underseen a little bit or not.
Yeah, I think it will suffer that as too. Yeah. But yeah, I totally agree with you there. I think sometimes, and we have seen it year after year, that even though, you know, something may open in October and have momentum, if something opens the week that a group like this is actually voting, it can be absolutely beneficial. It happened with American Hustle. Mm-hmm. New York film critics saw it the day before they voted, and it won. It's just, it's the kind of thing, it's like, it's fresh. It gives a certain advantage. So I mean, it all depends. There's arguments to be made about, you know, films with momentum like Spotlight. versus something that just opens, like Creed. So, which actually then brings me to, what do you guys have as your winner for best film from the National Board of Review?
I have Room.
I am back and forth on Room and Spotlight. Although something like a Creed wouldn't shock me, to be honest, you know, given what you just said. But
that would be too much.
Would you say?
That would be just too much. Oh, my God.
I think so, too. But
yeah. I mean, if I'll be honest, nothing will shock me with the National Board of Review. I mean, they picked, look at the last 2 years. They picked Her and what was last year? Our Most Violent Year.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of debating between those two films right now. I think that Spotlight is perhaps the more obvious choice.
My choice. I'm really locked into it.
Yeah. I do think that something like Room makes sense to me. I mean, they've kind of gone with, like, you know, slightly... I'm not going to say that Room is edgy, but for the Best Picture Oscar race it is, you know, like a kind of edgy in an Oscar way. And they've kind of... like, it kind of fits the template, I think, of previous film choices. And for whatever reason, it seems like... and maybe it's just coincidence, but it does seem like... A24 has kind of struck a chord with this group. I think if you look at kind of, I mean, they had one, like, got a crazy number of mentions last year for sort of a small studio. It was like, you know, picture, actor, supporting actress, directorial debut, you know, top 10 mentions in the, you know, independent list. I mean, it was just, it seemed to me like, you know, I don't know, maybe because they're based in New York as well, that they, you know, cater to that group, you know, more than others, but I don't know. That's kind of what I'm kind of basically wrestling with, both of those two as my choice for
Film. And I actually think, on at least on paper, I think A24 can have another really strong year with them, because they have Room, which I obviously think will do well. I think that Amy could win, or potentially win documentary, or at least make the top, because they have a top five for documentary, right?
Yeah.
So I make that. I can see, like, Ex Machina winning directorial debut. Then there's also, like, The End of the Tour making, like, the top 10, like, in the independent top 10, or, like, even Jason Segel winning supporting actor or something. Like, I can totally see any of those things happening, really.
Yeah, after last year, they could have another really super strong year. That would be really quite a coup for A24 to be able to get the best picture or best film here 2 years in a row.
True.
But it didn't turn out so well for A Most Violent Year, so.
No. True. And we shouldn't, and I'm sure you're about to mention it, but we shouldn't overlook the, in thinking about the National Board of Review there, the supporting actress curse.
Yes.
And keeping an eye on who wins that award.
Exactly, which I think will be great for us to reveal who we have, because I have Cynthia Nixon winning for James White.
Yeah. I'm leaning towards that, or I can really see someone like Jennifer Jason Leigh for Anomalisa, and
that's
not
my
plate.
Alternate. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I also kind of am leaning a little bit towards Jennifer Jason Leigh. You know, this group has been, I think, kind to, you know, like DiCaprio won for Django, you know, to kind of kick off, you know, I believe at that point the film was largely underseen, I think.
Yes.
Like, I don't think like the embargo hadn't lifted yet or anything like that, but they had seen it, and he won there. So I was kind of thinking about Jennifer Jason Leigh. But I don't know if I can do that to her.
That's why I only have her as my alternate, and for Anomalisa, because, you know, if she gets Oscar nominated, it's not going to be for that.
Right.
That only just boosts her. So yeah. I had to throw her away.
Yeah. If I predict her, I'll be, you know, happy to get the prediction right, but also really devastated for her.
True. I mean, she just can't catch a break, poor thing.
But I think... Eric, I think your prediction of Cynthia Nixon makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I could, you know, that seems to fall in line with some of the more low-profile winners, like the Ann Dowd.
Very, very character actress, Ann Dowd, and Compliance.
It is very, very much that. And I do think that the film, too, stands a fantastic chance at getting into the, you know, top 10 independent, and directorial debut. I have actually Josh Mond as my alternate in directorial debut. It feels like something that they're really going to respond to. Have either of you seen it?
No, but I really want to.
Oh my god, it's so good. Holy shit.
It hasn't come to DC yet. I don't even know what the release strategy is for the film.
I was actually looking for it, like, just to see how it's getting released, and it's like not anywhere, so I have no idea when it's actually happening, but hopefully soon.
Yeah, I think more people have seen an online screener of it than actually anything else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is, you know, doesn't bode well for anything other than, you know, possibly something like the NBR.
Exactly.
But going back to supporting actress Cynthia Nixon, Jennifer Jason Leigh, maybe a case could be made for someone like Kate Winslet, you know, kind of winning something like that. But I'm trying to think of
Jane Fonda.
I don't know. Doesn't
don't forget. I mean, don't forget. They also like to do a couple of things other than Warner Brothers. They like to just cover their studio bases in general.
Yeah.
And they love to get big stars at their party. And well, you better believe that Jane Fonda will show up.
She'll probably show up even though she's not even, like, a winner.
Probably. But, they probably know that, too.
Yes. But maybe, and another option is, maybe it would break the curse, but an option would be someone like Rooney Mara if they actually consider her supporting. I could see, you know, that also, her also making some waves there. And then I would imagine that would break the curse. But you
know. What about Alicia Vikander? Back in the day, they used to love giving like people a supporting actress win for like 12 movies.
Yeah, that's always something to look at in this is people that have multiple films in a year and where they fit with critics groups that do award multiple films for a single person. That's definitely something to look at.
Well, and she's obviously also viable in like Breakthrough. Alicia Vikander.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, she is, but I don't know.
I mean, I think Jacob Tremblay will win that.
Yeah,
but
they don't separate by gender like some other ones do. So
they used to.
Yeah.
But I believe last year it was combined into just one category. Yeah. Doesn't mean, who knows, they could break it out into two this year.
That's also true.
Yeah.
It may have been like, there wasn't a lot of support for, you know, a breakthrough actress last year, so they just combined it, and maybe there will be this year, and it'll be broken back up again. I don't know.
Yeah. I'm actually hoping that Rachel McAdams wins. I know that's a little bit shady, but, you know.
Whatever. I mean, whatever. Like, like I said, she's suffered enough. Winning the National Board of Review Supporting Actress would just be the final nail.
It would be great. Yeah. I would not shed too many tears for that.
It would be both a career highlight, winning something like that, and then an unfortunate low light, you know, kind of being snubbed on, you know, at the Oscars.
But, I mean, let's be honest, Rachel McAdams will take what she can get.
I mean, come on.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, so.
I like Rachel McAdams, so.
Mm-hmm.
She's whatever. I am really curious, though. I'm really curious. You brought up Rooney Mara a bit ago. With all of the crazy category fraud that we're seeing and where the critics are going to fall with a lot of this. I mean, I know there's three names that really are the biggest names in this, and that's Rooney Mara, Alicia Vikander, and Jacob Tremblay, all of which are being pushed supporting despite being co-leads in their films. But, I mean, all of them, I would guarantee, believe anyway, were submitted in supporting for SAG, so that's the only place they can be. But, like, the Golden Globes said, screw you, Rooney Mara and Alicia Vikander are lead. And that's a big deal. I think it's awesome. I was really glad that they did it. But I wonder if the Critics Awards, if either of them, you know, end up anywhere, and I think obviously Rooney Mara has a better chance than Vikander, and Tremblay a better chance than Vikander as well. If that is going to help shape a studio's decision. I mean, would would Harvey Weinstein change in the middle of a season to put her in lead? I think he could.
He could. Will he? I mean, it depends. I mean, the last thing I remember him doing that was for Christoph Waltz.
Yep.
But that also kind of, because it opened up a door for him to win an Oscar.
Yeah.
I highly doubt that Rooney Mara will be winning Best Actress regardless of what happens.
No.
I mean, who knows, but I doubt it.
That's not going to happen.
But supporting, if you know, the movie is well-liked, she can totally win that. I mean, who's she even going to lose to, really? If the movie's well-liked, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not, if Carol isn't well-received by the Academy, she can still lose to really anybody.
Yep.
But maybe. I don't. It's really tough to say. The thing is, I don't think the critics will buy her a supporting. Like, 100% they will not. I will be absolutely shocked if she wins any major supporting awards. I can see her kind of winning some kind of regional, you know, Oklahoma City something or other in supporting. But she's not going to actually win a major critics award in support. I would be really surprised about that.
No, I'm with you. I think she will probably be thrown around in the initial votes for New York and LA in lead.
Right.
And we all know, you know, what happened with LA's Best Actress category last year. So they're certainly willing to do whatever they want. But I'm curious. I think. Honestly, I think Weinstein should move her out of supporting and put her in lead. Because right now, we've had a locked top four of Best Actress for a really long time. And right now, it's only the fifth spot that kind of has an opening. And even right now, it's only two actresses that are really kind of fighting for it. And I think putting her in lead could totally lock it down. I honestly do.
I could see that, but I'm also kind of in the back of my mind rooting for Charlotte Rampling.
Mm-hmm.
So it's tough. Because, I mean, I think it would be nice for Charlotte Rampling to get an Oscar nomination. And I think this is, without a doubt, her only shot ever.
Mm-hmm.
Rooney Mara will have a lot more in the future. So, I mean, obviously, Harvey Weinstein will not be thinking about that, and he shouldn't be.
Yeah.
But that's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, I think that Charlotte Rampling has a really good deal, good amount of buzz at the moment.
Yeah,
and I do kind of expect her to show up at the, you know, New York Film Critics, and that'll be, you know, for, you know, add further fuel to the fire for her.
Yeah,
and potentially get something like a Golden Globe nomination. SAG, I'm, you know, not counting on, but maybe Golden Globe, you know, and BAFTA. So I think she's going to be reasonably strong, but I do agree that, you know, Rooney Mara entering the lead actress race would be an entirely different animal, as she would be, no offense to Rooney Mara, not calling her an animal, but entirely different animal in the sense that she's coming from a likely Best Picture nominee, very widely seen, where, you know, Charlotte Rampling definitely has the feeling of more of a one and done type of thing, where, you know, she would be the only nomination for 45 years. And people would be, you know, what I mean is Carol is definitely higher priority viewing.
Yeah.
So I think that definitely is in Rooney Mara's favor. And as well received as Charlotte Rampling's performance is, which it's been raved, so has Rooney Mara's. So it's not like one is, you know, particularly more acclaimed than the other.
Yeah.
And it's just a very, like you were saying, Eric, it's just a very different fight for the fifth spot when you add in someone like Rooney Mara, who's part of a likely Best Picture contender, for all we know, maybe even a top five contender with Todd Haynes getting in,
mm-hmm.
Versus the current battle between someone like Charlotte Rampling, who I have a lot of faith in at the moment because I think she's doing a lot of, you know, she was in Hollywood campaigning, she did, you know, the different roundtables, she saw nominating committee screenings, Q&As, I think she's doing a lot. More than
AFI tribute.
AFI tribute, I think, and definitely more than people anticipated that she would do. But she's fighting with, you know, Carrie Mulligan in Suffragette at the moment, and, mm-hmm. you know, that's, and maybe Lily Tomlin, you know, depending mm-hmm. on how the early precursors shape up with Golden Globe and SAG. But bringing in someone like Rooney Mara is definitely, would definitely complicate things for those contenders that are, you know, looking to be their film's only nomination.
That said, I do think 45 Years will play very well with the Academy. I think it's very Academy, like, to that age demographic, for sure.
Yeah, it is. And again, if I look at the list and, you know, somehow take Charlotte Rampling out and put Rooney Mara in, that is an extraordinarily young skewing top five. And when I look at it in those terms, I don't think that would happen. Yeah. Kate Blanchett would be the grand dame of the best actress race because everybody else would be in their 20s.
Yeah, which is, yeah. And Saoirse Ronan is like 21. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
Yeah, so in when I look at it like that, it seems like an impossibility. But also, too, you know, I'm looking right at the Gold Rush Kings best actress predictions, and everybody except for Long, who's probably just not updated his predictions, has Rampling in fifth place. Everybody, fives across the board, which, you know, makes her vulnerable. But I think you guys are right. I think that her age and her film will speak to the right portion of the Academy to get her in. Yeah. And if they do any amount of reading and realize that she's never been nominated, that could be, you know, another reason to go, oh my gosh, how has that ever happened?
Yeah. And I mean, while we have her in fifth, I mean, we're just kind of ranking, I guess, what we think is likelihood of nominations. But I mean, obviously, if she gets nominated, she will get nominated completely and totally on the strength of her number one votes. That's the only way that she would get in, is if that, like, a certain amount of people exclusively place her at number one. And I'm guessing that's where probably she will be on most people's ballots, either at number one or not there at all.
Yeah.
And sort of very last year with Marion Cotillard, who probably got in with a very small amount of mentions, but they were all number one.
Mm-hmm.
And while I have her at number five, I do feel that it's a decently strong number five. Like, obviously, like we were saying, someone like Rooney Mara entering the lead category would shake things up. But if it stays as it is, I do feel pretty good about her getting a nomination. And like you were saying, Eric, there is this narrative around, you know, around her never having been nominated, and, you know, that, and we, like Kenneth just mentioned, the AFI tribute, there's this real sense of, like, you know, let's honor Charlotte Rampling for her career in addition to this fabulous performance, you know, that's kind of moving in tandem, those two narratives, you know, that she obviously has the passion for her performance coupled with this kind of career narrative.
And I mean, and I think that Sundance Selects has done a phenomenal job with this film. They picked it up early. They got it to the right festivals. They built the buzz. They hired the right people. Cynthia Schwartz's people have run a fabulous campaign.
I was just going to say, that's, yeah, right there.
So they've done basically everything that they could do, they've done right. So if she doesn't get nominated, it's not going to be because of necessarily what they didn't do, because so far they've done everything that actually more than I would have thought would have happened for her.
Yeah, I agree. And something I want to call back to looking at this category is that the top four that we have are as the pretty locked, you know, ladies, Jennifer Lawrence, Brie Larson, Kate Blanchett, and Saoirse Ronan, are all in very realistic and likely best picture contenders. And that never happens.
Yeah.
Again, like you said, look at last year, which were the best actress nominees were not from Best Picture contenders, and this is a complete flip flop from that, and it's awesome. I couldn't be happier that that's the case. I think it's great.
And there, I mean, obviously we've all said what we said about Brooklyn many times, but in reality, all of those movies are pretty good movies. You know?
Well, you know, crickets. I mean, but yeah, no.
I'm not a fan of Brooklyn at all, and I think that's been clear, but it's not like it's some sort of horror show that's being nominated, you know? It's still a well-made, decent film. Yes, I think it's obviously been overrated, but that's completely besides the point.
It is, yeah. Same for me. I don't like it, but it doesn't mean that I don't know how it's going to play.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, and I think that, putting aside any personal opinions about that movie, but just like you were saying, Eric, looking at the overall category at the moment, at least, I mean, it is really shaping up. I mean, it's it's a fabulous year for that category. When you look at the films, that the strength, not only the strength of these performances, but also the strength of the films that they come from. Yes, you can make the case that, you know, some, that you may not believe that all four of those movies will make the Best Picture race, but that's almost, I mean, it would be obviously fabulous if they did. But for, you know, because that's so unusual for this category, like you were just saying, but even if they, even if, you know, one or two of them miss, they are still incredibly strong films in the Oscar race. And that's that, like you were saying, that's very unusual for this category, and really great to see that it's the actress category in which these films, their films are kind of grounded in the Best Picture race, while we are seeing kind of the opposite in the Best Actor, Lead Actor category, where it's more of a free-for-all, and, you know, the shape is, you know, what is there? There's maybe, the shape of the race is not really clear yet, and it, you know, there's maybe eight realistic contenders that are out there, and it'll really be the early precursors that kind of shape that for us.
Yeah, definitely.
And that, that category for me is by far the most difficult to predict at the moment, Best Actor. Like, I'm confident about one, completely confident about one person.
Yeah, me too. So, I'm confident about two, but yes, but really just one.
I mean, two, but exactly, that's where I am as well. Kind of two, but really one.
Yeah, and obviously that person is Leonardo DiCaprio. So,
and the second person for me would be Matt Damon.
Same for me. It's, yeah, it's 1-2, 1-2, all the way, all the way. So,
well,
it's...
Eric, tell us what you thought about Revenant. I haven't read your thoughts.
Okay, so yeah, so I saw The Revenant last night, and it was just a general industry screening. So it was Screen Actors Guild and Visual Effects and AMPUS and PGA and DGA members, and a very small venue. It's only like 50 seats. It's really small, which I would, you know, recommend anybody seeing the movie, see it on a larger screen than that if you can. But still, it was, I was really, I guess, unprepared for how majestic and gorgeous and amazing that it was going to be. I had high hopes for it. I really liked the trailers. I don't think the trailers do justice to it at all. It's so expansive. And I know a lot of people have made Terrence Malick comparisons, and that's totally valid because there's endless shots of, you know, streams and trees and stuff like that. But there's a lot of dreamlike quality to it, like Terrence Malick, but there is also a real quality to it, like sometimes like Stanley Kubrick used to have. Mm-hmm. And it almost seems like a really weird, neat combination of those two types of filmmakers. I was completely floored. It's 2 hours and 35 minutes, and the pacing of it is pretty much perfect. Stephen Mirioni is the editor who did Traffic. It is beautifully put together. The sound design is flawless. The score, oh my God, the score, oh my God. I hope it's eligible. I really, really, really hope it is. It's the best score I've heard this year. I don't think there is a possibility for DiCaprio to lose the Oscar. I don't see a possibility at all.
Yeah.
He's never gone this far physically and emotionally. And something that we had talked about on previous podcasts was that a huge difference from the book that it's based on was the addition of a son character for DiCaprio, who is killed and is really the real basis of the revenge tale that the movie is. And in a very efficient amount of time, the establishment of their relationship and DiCaprio's interaction with this kid is as, it's as emotionally strong and valid as Brie Larson in Room. He's that good. I had read so many things from people like, it's so violent and it's too violent. I actually did not find it overly violent at all. There's no, the violence is not gratuitous. It's not pornographic. Some things are even weirdly just out of frame on purpose, which is a completely genius thing to do because you're imagining things, which can often be worse than seeing it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I don't think I could really even talk about it enough about how good it was. I was not expecting the emotional pull from it because it is so, so, so heavy on action. It's set piece on set piece on set piece of action.
Yeah.
But the core and the theme of DiCaprio's feelings about his son and his wife go through the entire film, and they are the, it's the push for the whole story. So I realize I've talked a whole lot about it.
No, that sounds awesome. And outside of all the Oscar talk, it just sounds like a really fabulous movie.
It definitely is. Even outside of that, I would just, I cannot wait to see it again.
Yeah.
I think they've done a Dolby Atmos mix for it. So I want to go to a theater that has that.
Yeah.
Because it is extremely atmospheric. But it's getting back to DiCaprio and, you know, best actor race in that. There aren't any actors right now that are regularly working that have the the overdue narrative that he does, even though he's only, you know, whatever, 40. And, you know, he keeps kind of getting close, you know. He got close with The Aviator, and it wasn't really there. And he gets close, but it's like they keep kind of snatching it away from him. And I know people will make, you know, comparisons to, like, Peter O'Toole and Richard Burton, you know, for having been nominated so many times and never won. But they're British, they're not American, so
That's the thing. He is Hollywood.
I don't care. Yeah. He's Hollywood. He is really passionate about this. He is campaigning like crazy. It would be the biggest surprise to me of anything this year if he does not win. I mean, just all the way through.
I mean, it seems like he would be, from what you're saying, a pretty good bet in most years, but in this one in particular, it really is feeling, again, very similar to a Julianne Moore situation, where maybe even stronger because he will probably be in a Best Picture nominee.
I was going to make that exact comparison.
Where it's kind of just like, not only is it kismet as far as the role, but really the timing, where the race is kind of open enough for him to actually finally do it just like she did last year, where who is she even going to lose to, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. And that's the same with him. When you look at the list, and, you know, if anybody takes a peek at the Gold Rush Gang's best actor predictions, it's all over the place. It's a mess. There is no consensus the way that Best Actress is. And half of the performances don't come from predicted Best Picture nominees, which is something we can almost always guarantee. So it's like, it's a crazy, crazy mess. Mm-hmm. And, you know, not to dismiss DiCaprio's performance in this film, but it's the kind of messiness that I think he really, really needs to be able to win.
Well, I mean, probably, honestly, if you place like The Wolf of Wall Street in this year, you probably would have won that as well. This year, I mean, this year, that movie.
In this year. I don't know about that, because
to me, like, Eric, what you were kind of getting at was the emotional resonance of, like, this father and son relationship, that I think that the role is, you know, more emotionally moving or sympathetic than something like The Wolf of Wall Street would have been. I think that would be a challenging role to win with probably in most years.
Because Jordan Belfort was not a heroic character, even though, you know, really awful straight frat boy guys, you know, look at him as a role model. He's not. He's not a good guy. And this is a character that gives him all of the facets that he needs. It's I could not talk it up enough.
So I guess I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
One, is this like totally the DiCaprio show, or are we seeing a possibility for Hardy? That's question number one.
Okay.
And Hardy. question number two would be, do you think at all that there is a path for Iñárritu to win again? I ask this because just the way that you describe this movie, it is the polar opposite of what Birdman was.
Yep.
And the range that he was able to show back in back-to-back years, I'm sure will be impressive to some.
I don't know how it couldn't be, because it is exactly that. That is the polar opposite of Birdman in every possible way. I think it bodes probably a little bit better for Lubezki than it does for Iñárritu.
Right.
But I don't think it's that different. As far as Tom Hardy goes, as much as I love the movie, and I will call it a masterpiece, and I will give it 4 stars and all of that when I review it, Tom Hardy, shut up. Were you going to say something about Beasts of No Nation?
No, I said similar to Creed.
Oh, yes. Sort of similar to Creed.
Uh-huh.
But, okay, well, we'll talk about Creed later.
Or not.
No, I think Tom Hardy is actually kind of terrible in it. He's done like 4 different accents in movies this year. 2 in Legend, Mad Max, and Revenant. And they are all very extreme and over the top and really hammy. And one thing that everyone in The Revenant is not is hammy. So he stands out to me in a negative way.
Mm-hmm.
I think the comment I made on the forums was that he sounds like Tommy Lee Jones trying to read Kathy Bates' lines from American Horror Story Freak Show with a Baltimore accent. It's really pretty bad. It's bad. But it's fine. He's a villain.
And he has her beard.
Oh, my God. It might have been Kathy Bates. I'll have to double-check the credits. But, sure, I can see a path for him because DiCaprio is such a huge frontrunner, almost in a Jonah Hill kind of way. But, again, that category, too, supporting actor is, oh, mm-hmm. my God, there's, like, 10 guys.
Yeah.
And there are going to be huge snubs no matter who gets in. Huge.
Yeah.
I can see a path for him, yes. I hope there isn't one though.
Okay.
But he did his villain role fine, you know. It was very easy to hate him cuz he is a very terrible person.
Right.
But but I don't know. I think I would have liked to see somebody else in that. I don't think I really need to see Tom Hardy anymore. I've seen what he does. I am not impressed. I don't need him anymore.
Yeah.
So that's all. That's all about that, really.
Okay. Well, I mean, that's you know, it sounds like it's the real deal, and it's going to be sort of in basically every category it's up for. Oh, this screenplay. What about that? I guess that's the one that everyone's really down on.
Okay. The reason why they're down on it is because there's not a whole... All right. There is dialogue. There's not a whole lot of dialogue. Mostly. Yeah. DiCaprio doesn't have that much. Yeah. There's a lot of grunting, as people have said. But again, if people know the difference between the book and the film, I think it is really impressive. So I think it's in contention because there's a little bit more openness with adapted screenplay.
No, I actually think adapted screenplay is pretty competitive.
It is, I guess. I mean, like, original screenplay is pretty locked in. There's not a whole lot to get through.
Yeah.
Adapted, I could see there's strange things. There's, like, The Revenant and The Martian, which I feel both are, you know, like, top five films.
Yeah.
But I feel like those are films whose screenplay will be easy to dismiss.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of strange, because I think each of those screenplays are a huge part of the success of the film. I don't know. It depends on how, you know, those branches feel.
Eric, will you have The Revenant in any... Where do you have The Revenant in your National Board of Review and New York Film Critics predictions, just to go back to next week?
I have DiCaprio winning right now. Let's see. What else do I have?
New York or at National Board of Review?
National Board of Review.
Okay.
Yeah, I haven't gotten into New York yet. I just realized. Let's see. But the really weird thing is I don't have a place for it in the top 10 films, and I know I need to get it in there. I guess I should just read my top 10 films just so that we kind of have an idea of where that is. I can see a place to replace it, though. Mm-hmm. I have Black Mass, Bridge of Spies, Brooklyn, Carol, Creed, Joy, Mad Max, The Martian, Room, and Steve Jobs, with Spotlight winning. And I did have Sicario in earlier. I replaced it with Creed. But I can absolutely see a place for Revenant. I would probably take Joy out, I guess. But then, I don't know. Oh, my God. Maybe I should give up on Steve Jobs. It's, you know, it's the academic thing that's keeping Steve Jobs in for me.
Yeah.
And why I have Spotlight winning.
That the entire, like, cast and crew did, like, the National Board of Review Q&A. I mean, even Michael Fassbender joined for that.
Yeah, which I think is the only thing that he's done.
Yeah. So I also see that it's hard to see it missing, but at the end of the the day, there's a lot of films competing for these 10 spots.
I know. For me, Steve Jobs feels like, because I'm not very high on that film's chances in general, but I think with the National Board Review, I would be surprised if it doesn't make it in here. It just feels like something that they would totally go for, possibly in a number of places. I can see a top 10 mention and maybe like winning another award, like Sorkin winning screenplay, for instance.
Or even, and in looking at, Eric, I think your list makes a lot of sense. But even considering things like, I know we had just talked about, or maybe not just talked about it, but an hour ago talked about how Inside Out was not, we were doubting its, you know, Oscar Best Picture potential.
Mm-hmm.
That I could see it showing up in the National, either Inside Out or Annalisa, which we haven't talked much about, showing up in the National Board of Review top 10. Yeah. I mean, maybe Annalisa will be relegated to the independent list, but I do think, you know, they have been kind to Pixar films before, and we even saw the Lego Movie make the regular top 10.
That was WB.
Oh, WB. Oh, okay. But I think we could see something like Inside Out come back for something like this.
I can see it. I actually have. I actually
sort of do, like, we can't. You know, I'm having a hard time separating what I think the National Board of Review will go with versus what my, like, Oscar Best Picture predictions are, you know. Because it's not unusual for, you know, Best Picture nominees to not make the National Board of Review top 10. Often that top 10 at the National Board of Review is, as we know, like a total crapshoot, and it doesn't really make sense when you put it all together. But
I kind of feel
there,
like,
there will be some big snubs.
Yeah, I kind of feel like if I had to pick one of those kind of big top Best Picture contenders that I think won't make it, I actually would have to go with Joy here. It's screening really late. American Hustle also didn't make the top 10. Mm-hmm. So I can see them leaving that out. And what I can see them doing is giving it some kind of, like, visionary filmmaking award or whatnot to get some of the cast there.
Yeah, I can definitely see myself taking joy out and putting Revenant in.
Something like that.
Well, and what you were saying, Evan, about, you know, looking at crossover between, you know, an Oscar list and an NBR list, and, you know, how difficult it can be to kind of see that, they actually do pretty well. It was only until last year that they haven't, you know, really nailed a lot of, you know, Best Picture nominees. When a Most Violent Year won, it had been over 60 years since a winner there got zero nominations at the Oscars. So, thanks, Jessica Chastain. I think we all know who to blame is.
Like you were saying, maybe the kind of, like, you know, however we want to call it, like the National Board of Review anomalies or whatever, you know, the WB films kind of fill that space, and then you, you know, fill the rest with the major contenders or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Steve Jobs, if you don't believe it's a major Oscar contender.
Yeah, I do have Steve Jobs in here. I don't think it's going to be a Best Picture contender, though.
I mean, Steve Jobs to me is still, I'm getting total Ides of March tease. I think it's going to do really well at the Golden Globes, because they also like Sorkin, and just like Ides of March did well there, and I do, and I'm pretty sure the Ides of March made the top 10 at the National Board of Review. I can't off the top of my head remember, but I think it actually did. So very a lot of similarities between those movies to me. Kind of failed October Oscar bait.
I can totally see that. We were just talking about, you know, Inside Out and Anomalisa. Do you guys have it showing up at other places, either of those films?
Well, I think I would have Anomalisa maybe as an alternate in animated feature. I can see it winning screenplay or as an alternate there. Obviously, Jennifer Jason Leigh.
That's right where I'm at. I have it winning adapted screenplay. I have it, though, as the runner-up or the alternative, whatever, for animated feature, and then same with Jennifer Jason Leigh.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, makes sense, but I can totally see just being left into the independent top 10. Mm. Or I can see it making the actual top 10. It's on the cusp.
Yeah. Go ahead, sorry.
I said that they went with something sort of quirky like this before with Her, where they, you know, it won the National Board of Review, but that was also Warner Brothers.
Yes, that's true. What are you guys looking at for director?
I've been thinking this for a while that George Miller is going to win here.
I have that too. Jesus.
Just because he is highly acclaimed, Warner Brothers, and they not very rarely, but like in the last, I don't know, 10 or so years, they've gotten an Oscar nominee right in this category maybe like 3 times. Mm-hmm. So I don't think he'll be nominated at the Oscars, so he just thought it makes a lot of sense to me here.
Yeah, I like him as a winner here as well. I do have Tom McCarthy as a spoiler, but still.
I could see Tom McCarthy. I could see Ridley Scott. I could see Inarritu as well, actually.
Yeah.
I think those all make sense. I think Miller is maybe the most obvious choice given, the acclaim for the movie and the WB connections, and just the showiness of the direction, too. Maybe somebody random like Spielberg, you know, could also be in the mix. Unclear really how strong Bridge of Spies is. And we know it definitely should have a block of voters in the industry that will vote for it, but it's still kind of one of those films that's, you know, its true position in the race, whether it's top five or not, is pretty unclear at the moment.
I mean, I think Bridge of Spies are just probably, at least with the NBR, play similar to War Horse and Lincoln, both of which got a top 10 mention and nothing else.
That's what I have. I don't see, I mean, it seems like a really easy prediction that Bridge of Spies would be here, to me.
Yeah,
in the top 10, yeah.
Yeah, but nothing else. I know some people are looking to, like, Mark Rylance to hit some of these.
I think he has probably maybe an outside chance, but I wouldn't predict him.
Yeah.
And I do think Ridley Scott, you know, I could see them going with him as well. I noticed that he did like a kind of a career Q&A or something like that with the National Board of Review. So he's also out there. As we know, WB's pushing hard for, I mean, not the, Fox is pushing hard for him. And, you know, it's becoming sort of a, you know, there's this career narrative around him as well. So something to consider. But I do think that for the purposes of National Board of Review, someone like George Miller checks off a lot of boxes.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's absolutely the case. Let's take a look at supporting actor, because I think there is some fun to be had here in this category. I currently have Michael Keaton winning this, because I don't think that if Spotlight is going to win, that it's going to be its only win. It's going to have to show up other places too, and I have it in screenplay as well. But my alternate, my back pocket, is Sylvester Stallone for Creed, which I know is something that we should be talking about since we've talked a little bit about this in the forums, and there's certainly a lot of disagreement to Stallone's validity as a contender in this race. I think he's a total contender. I think he is a potential Oscar winner. Even missing like SAG, which he's going to totally miss. But Creed is Warner Brothers. It would be a place to keep rewarding Warner Brothers here at the National Board of Review. I have Johnny Depp in as my alternate in actor too, so I'm kind of looking at where they're going to populate their WB films. I'm not quite ready to put Stallone in as a winner with NBR, but I only have really a few hours to do that because I need to publish our predictions before the announcement. But I want to hear from you guys, one, on your supporting actor predictions, and then also a little bit on the Sylvester Stallone stuff. So go.
So I think that he stands a great shot at National Board of Review. And as we were just saying, you know, sometimes the overlooked importance of kind of having the buzz of the moment when these groups are voting, and I think he definitely has that. Not that the, you know, National Board of Reviews aren't littered with, you know, wins that, you know, make no sense when looked at through that lens, but I think that, you know, the buzz is very tangible at the moment for him, and he would make a lot of sense to win there. I think you bring up the WB connection, which I think is important to remember. And they don't really have necessarily a strong supporting actor contender outside of him. I mean, there was obviously they're pushing Joel Edgerton, but I don't really see that happening, you know, him winning any awards for that. But they are definitely pushing him. So I think he makes sense as a winner here. And, you know, in general, I think having just seen Creed last night, I can, you know, easily see why he is, made such an impression in this race. It's not only is it a very kind of charismatic performance, you get to the dramatic material in it, it's also kind of charming and, you know, the comedic elements and whatnot and the nostalgia of it. But he also gets really great material, you know, this kind of harrowing cancer storyline, and that has been pretty well publicized. And, you know, I think he makes a lot of sense. I think that, you know, at first people were thinking that this Rocky connection and Stallone's general reputation were going to be a negative for him. Mm-hmm. But it's turned into a positive. It's part of the narrative. It's part of the story. You know, Stallone, you know, however many years later, revisiting the Rocky character in this kind of real or raw way.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've been a pretty vocal... I don't want to say critic, per se, because I only saw the movie last night, which was fine, but... So I've been pretty vocal about kind of doubting Sylvester Stallone's chances pretty much from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
And I will say that I will have to take some of that back, because you can't deny the fact that he's in the race, very much so. But I'm not really ready to proclaim him a slam dunk.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I think, obviously, we love to say this, if the Oscars were voted on today, yeah, he'd probably win the whole damn thing. But they're not. You know, they're not voted on today, and the buzz for him right now at the moment is obviously huge. It's huge for the film. It's mainly because people love a surprise story, and this has taken everyone by surprise. No one expected this. The bar was very low for any Rocky movie, and it has exceeded that, with critics, reputable critics, calling it the best film of the year. So that's a big deal. Obviously, the box office is a big deal, and his character is also a big deal. All of it is very, very baity. So if you add all that up together, he's obviously a contender. Now, will he be a contender a month or 2 months from now? I still remain slightly dubious about that. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's where I'm at. I would put him in the running, but not a slam dunk. I have a very solid top four in supporting actor at the moment that I'm very comfortable with, and he's kind of in contention for that fifth spot for me.
See, I think weirdly he's going to end up being stronger down the line than right now, because right now he's going to very likely miss out on things like the Globe and a SAG nomination because of timing. But his narrative is being built now so that by the time it gets to Oscar voting, it'll be there.
Yeah, I agree with you, Eric. I think that his narrative is already very strong. I mean, there's just so much goodwill at the moment, you know, and buzz, that I think once the train starts moving, it becomes difficult to stop it, and I think it's just going to kind of keep building, which I think is what you're saying.
Yeah.
I will say that if there is somebody who can kind of counter that, I don't want to say Sylvester Stallone has an overdue narrative. It's more just like goodwill and like I don't think anyone would think he's overdue. That's not really the narrative, but I think somebody like Michael Keaton also will have that narrative going as well, although I don't think that performance is, you know, is definitely not as overtly, you know, Oscar baity as what Stallone is doing in Creed.
True, but I mean, one of the things, and you're definitely right, Kenneth, the bar was very low going into this. But I think the thing that surprised people from Stallone's performance and how it's written is how subtle it is. He doesn't have these big crying jags, or they don't overdo the cancer stuff at all. He doesn't ham it up at all. He has a few like teary moments, but they are so restrained that you're looking at him in a really different light. Like, okay, is this actually a real performance? Because it is. And I was certainly surprised by that. I certainly didn't go in thinking, like, I am going to be totally Team Stallone. I just, you know, was hoping it would be a good movie. I like Ryan Coogler, so. And I was genuinely surprised. And I think that's going to be part of that narrative for him. And I've made a similar comparison to Mickey Rourke, and I do think it's kind of similar, where you have somebody that's never been necessarily regarded as a great actor, but they get the role that allows people to see them differently. And, you know, he does also have the benefit of being a previous nominee.
Mm-hmm.
So I just feel like, feel like the timing is right. I feel like kind of everything is right for that.
I mean, I can see all that. I can see all that. I'm just a little.
I do agree with you, Eric. I think we sometimes overstate, like, oh, this person is so disliked, or this person has such a bad, you know what I mean? almost anybody with the right role, you know, some narrative will be formed around them if the role is right and the timing's right. And, mm-hmm. and sometimes it just happens, you know. And like you were saying, nobody was necessarily thinking James Coburn was some, you know, greatly overdue actor. But the narrative started. He, you know, came back and delivered a great performance that surprised people in an acclaimed contender, and it just kind of rolled from there. Obviously, he was less of a sure thing, you know, in the race throughout most of the season, but mm-hmm. the buzz was...
I mean, I agree with that, and I've said many, many times that I really do believe that anyone can win an Oscar under the right circumstances. I totally agree with that. Where I was coming from with all the doubt was I just didn't really buy the fact that Sylvester Stallone playing Rocky, considering all the implications and the kind of baggage of that, would work. But clearly, that is not happening. People are responding to it, and that's actually, like Evan said, it's almost becoming a positive for him that he is playing Rocky. Like it really is like a redemption of sorts for him, not only for the character but for Stallone himself.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, but I also kind of disagree with what you said about him not making the Golden Globes. I mean, he probably I can see him getting nominated there. Actually, Saga would be tougher because it's so soon, but the Globes.
Yeah, I mean, maybe the Globes. I could see that. I have a hard time seeing him being able to make it into SAG. It's just too. They're already into it, and I think it's pretty strong that a lot of times when people are voting for things, whether it's Oscars or elections or whatever it is. When you have your ballot early, you vote early.
Yeah.
You vote for what you want, and then you do it, even though there's still another week to go. So I think it just might be a little bit too late for him in that. As opposed to, like, James Coburn, who did actually get a Screen Actors Guild nomination as well. But
that was a completely different time, in the sense that the season was a lot longer.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think, though, that what Kenneth said regarding the Golden Globes, I do think that he should be able to get a nomination there. It's obviously a much easier get than something like SAG, considering the voting body is much, much smaller.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So what I mean is that it's likely that, you know, most of the Golden Globe voters will be able to see the movie before they vote.
And he has a lot of buzz, and he's, like, still a star of sorts. People know who he is. I mean, they would want him to show up as... And, you know, so I can see him getting nominated there. Yeah, for sure. Something like BAFTA would be tough for him, but.
Yeah, I think that would be a little bit more difficult.
Although if he's the Oscar favorite.
Right. If he's the Oscar favorite at that point, he'll probably be nominated. So.
Yeah, that's true.
But this race is still, I mean, it's very, very open, the whole thing.
It is. So, do you guys want to move on to New York?
Sure.
I think we should. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, we're at an hour and a half. Goodness. This is going to be one of those long ones, folks, but you love it. So, here it is. All right. I think we're going to be looking at largely a very, very different set of winners with New York than something like NBR. I'm not quite sure what you guys have. I could go and peek at yours, but I'll just let you reveal what your winners are. We do know historically that New York likes Todd Haynes quite a bit. They also do like giving out multiple awards. And for myself, I do have Carol winning Best Picture. I have Todd Haynes winning Director. I have Rooney Mara winning Supporting Actress. So, that's where I'm at with New York right now. what are you guys thinking? And, I mean, especially, I guess, in terms of Carol.
I do think that Carol will do very well here. Best Picture, I think Carol stands a really great shot. I think it's... You know, most people will probably agree that it's between Carol and Spotlight for Best Picture. You know, some people are leaning in one direction or the other.
Yeah.
But I can a case to be made for either one. Like you said, clearly Todd Haynes has a history here, having done well in with previous films, most notably Far From Heaven. Mm-hmm. And So I would, you know, I'm not quite sure where I'm going to lean for picture one versus, you know, Carol versus Spotlight, but I do think that Todd Haynes will win director. Rooney Mara, I could see winning lead actress instead of supporting, actually.
Yeah.
I think she's definitely in the running. I don't know that they'll put her in supporting. If they do deem her supporting, I think she obviously could easily win. Mm-hmm. But I guess it depends on, you know, like how, you know, I don't know what the deliberations will be behind the scenes, how political it will be, you know, if people will want to throw her there and give her an easy win, or if they'll want to, you know, put her where she belongs. I don't know. But I do think that she has a great shot to win lead actress, you know, but will have tougher competition from the likes of Charlotte Rampling, who I expect to do well here. Yeah. Potentially, you know, Brie Larson, even Saoirse Ronan, you know, seem to have a lot of support in New York. So I think all of the it'll be a very competitive lead actress category. But I think Mara, if I had to guess, will be considered there as opposed to supporting actress.
You're probably right there. I think I should probably play around with that a little bit more. Kenneth, what are you thinking?
I mean, strangely enough, now that I just thought about Carol, I actually think I only have it for one, maybe two wins there. Director, I think I would be absolutely floored if Todd Haynes doesn't win the director here. Just, A, considering how much they've liked this film, considering how much they liked him in the past, and just how much of a New York film this actually is.
Mm-hmm.
So I really think that... I would be really shocked if he doesn't win there. And I think that it has a good shot also, like, in cinematography. I think that could... Carol, maybe The Revenant, even though I think Lubezki has been awarded so much recently that I think that maybe they'll go in a different direction, even if they... I'm sure they'll think it's deserving. Plus, I do think that some of the reactions from the New York critics have been kind of muted for The Revenant coming out of the initial screening. So... Carol, I could see getting cinematography, or Mad Max, I can see getting cinematography, but those are really the only categories that I'm leaning towards Carol at the moment. Obviously, could win picture, for sure, but I kind of slightly leaning towards Spotlight there.
Hmm.
And then support, I mean, I also think that Rooney Mara will be in contention to win lead, not supporting, as will Cate Blanchett, but...
Maybe a joint award for both of them. I don't know.
Oh my god.
I kind of imagine that neither will win, if I had to guess.
Yeah.
I think that Carol has a much better chance to win picture and director than it does either one of the actresses winning there, if I had to guess.
That's a good point. Also would be, it would hark back to Far From Heaven.
Mm-hmm.
That would be kind of weird.
I don't like talking about the New York film.
I know. It would be very strange to have a total redux like that, though.
I know. What about lead actor, though, Eric? What are you predicting? That seems to me to be
very,
very kind of up in the air. No, necessarily obvious contender. We might think DiCaprio, although Kenneth just said that some of the early reactions from members of the New York film critics were less enthusiastic than others, so maybe... some uncertainty there.
Yeah, I have DiCaprio as an alternate, but I have Ian McKellen winning for Mr. Holmes. I'm a little less bullish on that than I was when I first made that prediction, but I do feel like the category is really open. It's a well-loved film. He is campaigning his ass off. I feel pretty good about it. I'm just a little bit wobbly.
I think it's tough to feel really good about really anything in that category because it's so messy. But I've been sort of eyeing Ian McKellen there for a while as well. He has, outside of the fact that he's campaigning, he has absolutely rave reviews.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's like a really long-time respected actor. He hasn't won any kind of major award in film since for a while. I mean, I think he won the New York... Actually, I don't think he won the New York Film Critics for
Gods and Monsters.
He did not. I think Nick Nolte won the New York Critics that year, and he won LA and National Society. So he's never won the New York Film Critics Award, if I'm not mistaken. So I could see there being a push there for for him, especially considering that this category is very wide open. I wouldn't completely discount Michael Fassbender here either.
I was just thinking about that, because even though, you know, everybody's reported about how bad the box office is and that it's basically sank the film and a lot of people have pulled it out of predictions, etc., the reviews were really, really stellar. And a lot of them came from New York. So
yeah, so I could see him I could see him winning there, as well as for Macbeth, which he's also gotten some good reviews for that as well, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. I could see him. He would be an interesting double winner at, you know, NBR, so National Society.
Even though I don't necessarily think he's getting an Oscar nomination per se, but that didn't stop the New York Film Critics the last 2 years from awarding someone who didn't get an Oscar nomination. So
true.
Yeah.
Yeah, so McKellen was second place in New York for Gods and Monsters, yep. But he won NBR.
Yeah.
There
you go.
Yeah, I think it was McKellen won LA and NBR, and Nolte won the other two.
Oh, okay. From
what I remember.
Okay.
Wow. But I do think that I was going to, before it was brought up, I was going to bring up Michael Fassbender, because I do think people are quick to dismiss that film. You know, maybe within reason, given the, you know, the headlines were not kind and the general buzz was, you know, pretty toxic after that. But I do think that, you know, like you were saying, Eric, you know, Fassbender got great reviews. I think he's one to I think it would be a mistake to disregard him due to that buzz at like somewhere like the New York Film Critics.
Yeah, yeah. And I've been very down on Steve Jobs, and I don't ultimately think it'll make it to the very end, but it's not a movie that's like so dead that it won't show up anywhere.
Sure.
It's probably going to be like, I think it'll do well at the Globes. I think it'll make the Broadcast Film Critics top 10. I think it'll probably, you know, do reasonably well with the guilds.
Yeah, because I think going back to it, you know, the box office may say otherwise, but in terms of like industry voters, I do think it's a movie in contention, a movie in the Best Actor category especially, that nearly everyone will actually see, you know, as opposed to maybe some of the other fringe contenders. Like, it'll be, you know, very widely seen, which will, like Kenneth was saying, I think it'll show up at some of these places because it has been one of the more widely seen contenders, you know, compared to your, you know, Mr. Holmes or The Danish Girl or...
Mr. Holmes and Steve Jobs made almost the same amount of box office.
True, but I think that, I was speaking less to box office and more in terms of, like, people in the industry actually seeing them. I think Steve Jobs will be very widely seen, regardless of the, you know, the box office story there.
Well, Universal has a better screener game than
Roadside
Attractions does right now, so.
Yeah. And we had the reports in October of the overflowing Academy screenings. Of course, if it's, you know, where to, you know, of course every film is supposedly playing well to the industry, but
I know, right?
Carol.
Yeah. Except that one, film is seemingly, you know, has, you know, industry voters, you know, singing its praises as they leave the screening, so we obviously take those with a grain of salt.
At least 30 of them.
Yes, well.
But anyway, I'm not predicting Steve Jobs, you know, to have a resurgence and get a Best Picture nomination, but more just pointing out that I don't think it's going to be, you know, totally off the radar in the precursors or anything like that.
So you're saying that it'll be present in the race.
Yeah.
I mean, I agree. That's why I have it in the NBR top 10. I think there's obviously groups that don't give a shit about, you know, the box office or, you know, backlashes or whatever. They just don't care. I think the Oscars are a little different, and there's a very big difference between something that is a low grosser versus something that is a certified flop. That's a big difference.
Yeah. And I mean, and I really do not remember in all of the years that I've been paying attention to any of this, ever a movie having this kind of toxicity around its box office.
Mm-hmm.
Like when it became the story of this movie. In as negative of a way as possible.
I think the main problem with it is that people made too many comparisons to The Social Network, which did very well, and you know, it had the same writer, so it was like, oh, it's going to be basically the same kind of movie, so here's what our box office expectations for it are. And then, you know, it had its good limited release, and people were bullish on that. We're like, oh, okay. And then it went wide, and people, it shit the bed.
Yeah.
And everybody ran. Just ran.
Well, I mean, clearly Universal, that was really the problem. Universal dropped the ball there as far as the expansion model.
Mm-hmm. It also just, you know, dug hard into their huge, massive box office year. So,
yeah.
But anyway, enough about Steve Jobs. My God.
Right.
Let's you, Evan, you mentioned Charlotte Rampling earlier. And strangely, we did not even talk about our best actress predictions for NBR. And I'm looking at mine, and I have her winning both. I feel like she is a great contender for these kind of things, for these awards. I feel really good about it. I think it will also be the push and the thing that she'll need to secure herself as in top five. But I feel really good about Rampling here.
Yeah, I could go. That makes total sense to me. I think I'm going with Brie Larson for the National Board of Review, and then Charlotte Rampling for the New York Film Critics.
And that's where I am as well. Even though I will say this, I think that Best Actress, and I think Evan brought this up earlier, in New York in particular, will be extremely competitive. I think all of these women have phenomenal reviews. You know, just for instance, Brie Larson, for the review for Carol, Dana Stevens brought up Brie Larson in that review, which is, I don't remember anything happening like that before, like where you have one reviewer reviewing one film and bringing up another actress in terms of awards in that same review. So they clearly all have their fans, and I'm guessing it'll be a bloodbath. I can kind of potentially see like some kind of compromise happening there. I really do think it'll be a very fractured vote.
I do too. I think it might be the most difficult vote.
Yeah.
Because
it's just to the strength of the year too.
It is. It's the strength of the year. It's how much they're going to want to go in with Carol. It's where they're going to put Rooney Mara. Yeah. So I think there's definitely that. And I just realized that I have Charlize Theron in Mad Max as my alternate for both NBR and New York. I am insane. That's crazy.
I wish.
I know. I would.
I'm going to take her out of New York as my alternate, but
that would be really awesome.
But
I do think that, you know, if it is very competitive, as we suspect that it will be in somewhere like New York, and Kenneth was mentioning, will there be some kind of compromise choice? Although it's hard to call anybody in this race a compromise choice because they all have such, you know, phenomenal reviews and, you know, likely fan bases and whatnot, but. I kind of, going to that point, when you think about these contenders, it's like, you know, Carol could be awarded elsewhere. But it's, you know, like, who's not going to get behind Charlotte Rampling winning Best Actress, you know? So I don't know. I kind of do think that even with a competitive race, that I kind of think she'll come out on top.
See,
there.
Where I thought you were going with this, so you're going to talk about a compromise award, I thought you were going to say that Charlize Theron might win as a compromise.
But that happens all the time, and we have seen this all the time. Isn't like Rachel Weisz?
Mm-hmm.
She was not in like the top two in all of the series of votings, and then all of a sudden, there she was at the end in like the final count. It happens. It totally happens.
Yeah. So
I imagine this is the category where we'll be like, you know, refreshing Twitter for like an hour before it's announced.
Yeah, absolutely.
As if we wouldn't be refreshing Twitter for the best actress pick already.
But I know, exactly.
But this will get rid of people at the end.
Because I imagine if I had to guess, unless we're just misreading the race and one of these contenders just has so much more support than the others, which isn't clear at the moment, I imagine the deliberations will go on for quite a while.
Yeah.
I think so, too. I think longer than most of these categories. And again, that really speaks to how strong this year is, so yay for that.
But we haven't even, I know that there, some people aren't fans of it, but we haven't even really talked about Saoirse Ronan, and I still think even Saoirse Ronan is in the mix for the New York Film Critics. You know, I mean, she may not win, but I think she definitely has her fans as well. You know, I mean, so it's going to be competitive.
I mean, she'll have her votes for sure, but I would be very surprised if she actually won. I guess she might also be some kind of weird compromise choice, if anything.
Mm-hmm. I could see that too. Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, the movie has fantastic reviews, except for Richard Brody.
A New York Film
Festival who is a brand new addition this year.
Yeah.
So you know he's going to say hell no to that.
Well, hopefully he sticks to his guns.
Oh, yeah. My God, please. I'll need to tweet him constantly, like, Slayton.
Oh. But, Eric, going back to your earlier point, even somebody like Jennifer Lawrence, I mean, Joy will likely be the last film that New York film critics see before they vote. Mm-hmm. We know that at New York film critics, they have no problem awarding, you know, the same actress, you know, multiple times. Oh, yeah. So even, she's probably in the running,
well,
too.
Well, only if her name is Meryl Streep, though.
Yeah.
But still, I mean...
Which means I'm going to put Ricky in the Flash as my alternate.
Mm-hmm. That's not true. They have no problem giving Julianne Moore multiple runner-up mentions.
Oh. Oh, my God.
Okay, bye.
That hurt. That
was... Well, I mean, but then again, some people don't get any mentions whatsoever. I like, and they have to go to theater to get win an award.
Oh my goodness! Oh my goodness! The blood! The blood! It's all over the floor. Okay. Let's. All right. I guess we should maybe get back on track. I would never turn a conversation back to Saoirse Ronan, but maybe I should. I don't know how I feel about her here. I guess it's the place that she would do the best. It's her best shot.
Yeah.
Maybe.
She's also, I think, in the mix for a National Board of Review as well.
I mean, to me...
Yeah, I would say
as
more
much
there.
As Brooklyn was really well-reviewed, as much as she's gotten fabulous reviews... I still struggle to really see people saying, yes, I'm going to award her or this film best of the year. That's just, maybe I am approaching it from, because I have a bias, maybe I'm going to say that outright, but that's just how I feel. I just think that in this competitive race, they have other options, and unless she's a straight up compromise choice where everyone's like, yeah, we all like her well enough, but like there's some kind of two camps fighting it out and they're all like, whatever, just give it to her. I don't really see her actually winning on her own like that. So that's just how I think.
Yeah, it feels like it would be a strange win.
Yeah. Although we shouldn't overlook the, you know, obviously the acclaim that she's received.
Oh, absolutely not.
Received.
Absolutely not.
You know, she clearly has a leg to stand on when it comes to, you know, among these other women when it comes to critical acclaim.
For sure, and I have no doubt that she'll have her fans in that room. But ultimately, I see, I would put the other four that we talked about ahead of her. Both women from Carol, Brie Larson, and Charlotte Rampling.
Mm-hmm. Now, hopefully her luminosity just lights everybody else up and puts her in the shadow. So,
yeah,
that's where I'm at with that. Sorry about it. Well, geez, gosh, that actually gets us really, really well covered. What else do we have coming up next week besides everything in the damn world? So just
isn't LA next weekend?
Yeah, just so that you know, we have our oh my God, it's Sunday. Yes, National Board Review is Tuesday, December 1st. It's right now Sunday the 29th. The very next day, Wednesday, is the New York Film Critics Circle. Then both Boston and Los Angeles vote on Sunday the 6th. Mm-hmm. Screen Actors Guild noms come out on Wednesday, December 9th, and Golden Globe Thursday, December 10th. So basically, I won't be sleeping or eating for the next, like, 13 days. That's a lot.
That probably do some good.
I know. That's a lot.
But it's always such a fun time of the season because, you know... Once, like, you know, two Sundays from now, you know, this race could look totally different depending on what happens. And, you know, you could throw out what we've said, throw it out the window because it could be all, you know, likely all, you know, shaken up in some way.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And I can't wait to do, you know, a podcast next Sunday after Los Angeles and Boston have just, you know, revealed theirs.
Yeah.
That'll be fun too. But yeah, I'm really kind of, I'm hoping that what we see come from this week from New York and National Board of Review, half of me wants to, you know, see the race, you know, start to take shape. And the other half of me wants to see some total craziness that turns everything upside down. I want both.
I mean, and there will be.
Yeah.
There always is. I mean, there's no way the National Board of Review is going to be straightforward. They never are. And New York usually throws in some kind of curveball. I mean, did people really think Marianne would win last year? No. Did. So there's always something that gets, you know, sort of thrown this way or that way. Well, American Hustle, obviously, 2 years ago, basically sweeping.
Yeah, really. Watch Joy come in and win Best Picture, and everybody's like, what is happening?
Right. So, you know.
I would love that. Yeah. I would die.
And I still think that, you know, Jennifer Lawrence, you know, could, you know, I think definitely think she will at least be in the mix of the New York Film Critics and National Board of Review. I mean, National Board of Review is seeing Joy today, you know, so, I mean.
Yeah.
And by all accounts, you know, one thing that's been consistent across all the early reactions of Joy has been the, you know, adoration for her and her performance. So, I mean, I think it's unwise not to put her in the mix as well.
Well, I'll tell you this much. If Jennifer Lawrence actually does, I mean, National Board of Review, whatever, but if she wins New York Film Critics Circle so soon after winning recently, you have to believe that she's coming for another Oscar this year.
Oh, she definitely is this year. She's in it.
So if she wins that award, I don't think she needs critics wins to win another Oscar this year, but if she does get them, I think that it's going to become kind of an undeniable narrative for her, where she's like, we must award her because she's so good. And
yeah.
And that really is the only way I think she'll win, if she becomes truly undeniable.
Yeah. Although I was just thinking, I mean, I know we're running over, but who the last time that an actress won her second Oscar did it without Critics Awards.
Oh my god.
Because Hilary Swank got critical.
She did.
Jodie Foster did.
She did. Sally Field.
Meryl Streep did.
Sally Field.
Sally Field.
Did not.
Mm-hmm. Did not. Well, I mean, I'm sure someone's waiting to refute that or something, but yeah.
Well, I mean, major Critics Awards, obviously. Yeah. And in the days of Sally Field, there were only like five or six groups, period.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. That was a very different time. But something that we do bring up about these second best actress wins, especially in terms of Hilary Swank and Jodie Foster, is that those second wins came with best picture wins as well.
Yeah.
Which is why up to this point, you know, I've been of the thought that, you know, Lawrence can't win unless Joy wins. In talking to Sasha Stone, she did say that she thinks that Lawrence can win without Joy winning, that she's that good. I'm not sure if I agree. Obviously, I think Lawrence, as a personality and as a public figure, is in a very different category than Hilary Swank and Jodie Foster.
Yeah, for sure.
So is the role. So making such a direct comparison, I don't think is going to serve anybody that well. We have it as, you know, a bit of statistic, but I don't think it's that good of a comparison, because Lawrence is just the biggest thing in the world right now.
Yeah. I mean,
that's the thing. I mean, she has won very recently, but, you know, it's kind of in a situation where I think, Eric, which is what I think you were getting to, was that when you were dealing with somebody who was the biggest, you know, movie star in the world, it's, you know, kind of like all bets are off.
Mm-hmm.
That's true, but just to play devil's advocate, I do still think that a lot of people in the industry, especially older people, will be uncomfortable giving a second Best Actress Oscar to someone at 25 years old after she won her first just 2 years ago. I really do think that. That she has to basically be, that make them kind of almost feel like they have to award her and they have no other choice. And a lot of, and again, winning Oscars, a lot of it has to do with who you're up against. Jodie Foster, when she won her second Oscar, not only was she the Best Picture winner, but she was up against Thelma and Louise, who they could not separate at all.
Hillary Swank was up against who? I mean, it was, that race was weak as hell, really. So we already have already at the moment a strong alternative.
Yeah.
So this is an interesting race, but Jennifer Lawrence, I still think to win would have to be completely, she would have to run the gamut.
I totally agree with your assessment that the years that, you know, Foster and Hillary won their second, the competition was not as strong, and this is not the same this year. This is an incredibly competitive Best Actress year, where there are possibilities for almost any of at least our top four. I would say top five, but I would say there's a strong case to be made for almost any of them. So yeah, I think you're right that she probably does need to run the gamut so that, you know, it doesn't seem like, oh, okay, she's the biggest star in the world and there she is. It'll certainly bring in viewers after a lackluster year this year.
Right. And, you know, and people love a whole, I mean, again, because she's already such a huge star and she's an Oscar winner, and people love kind of the whole sort of crowning somebody new and fresh idea. And she's, as much as young as she is, I don't really feel like she feels new and fresh anymore. She's a huge megastar. And I do think that a lot, that there will be people who would think that she really need more, per se. So it's a really tough, I'm not saying that she can't win, nor am I saying I wouldn't predict her to win 100%. We'll see how this season turns out. But I think that there's a lot sort of standing in her way, and she's going to have to overcome a lot, I think, to actually win again so soon at 25. I mean, this is like unheard of.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
And I was just going to say that this is that I do think that, you know, we still don't have a great idea of just how acclaimed Joy is going to be or how acclaimed Jennifer Lawrence will be. I mean, you know, 2 weeks from now when the embargo is lifted, you know, and she's getting career best notices, the complexion of the race changes again, you know. So, you know, we just don't know how, you know, we know that she's a huge star. We know that, you know, this performance is already getting buzz and has been for a while. And based on the, you know, the tweets, we know that, you know, this is the thing that everyone can most agree on that is, you know, that they're drawn to is her performance in the film. You know, I know that Eric, you mentioned Sasha Stone talking about, you know, how much she loved Jennifer Lawrence as well and thought she was going to be a contender for the win. You know, if it's going to be this kind of performance, I think she, whether she wins or not, she's going to be very competitive.
Oh, I think she'll definitely be competitive. That's for sure. But career best, I mean, Kate Blanchett is also getting career best notices right now. So it's really tough because I have no doubt that she's going to get completely raved. Like, I will be shocked if she isn't, regardless of how the film is received. So, but just somehow, in the back of my mind, I feel like she just needs it to go 100% her way to win again, right now. And I just don't know if it will. Maybe it will, but I don't know.
Well, she's clearly making every effort for that to happen.
Oh, absolutely. So. Absolutely.
And I mean, that's actually one thing you mentioned, that, you know, the luster of her being, you know, this ingenue that they get to reward is off. But I would almost argue that just between 2012 and 2015, she's a different person in every possible way. She is more mature. She is outspoken. She is, I feel like she has really transformed into, I don't know, to something very serious compared to just 3 years ago. And I think that will be recognized. I don't know. I feel like they're not going to be, oh my God, we just gave her a win 3 years ago. I don't know.
Yeah. I think that you know, the cards for her are definitely there to be played to, you know, be very competitive and push very hard for a second Oscar. I think what you were talking about, Eric, you know, this kind of maturity and, you know, the beginning with the letter that you referenced earlier, which, you know, was obviously, you know, you know, very, very wonderfully, you know, kind of written and well received. And I think that it has been a that is kind of emblematic of who she is to Hollywood at the moment.
Oh, I mean, absolutely, I agree with that 100%.
Yeah, it's just her that letter just really busted the doors open in Hollywood and made everybody talk about the pay inequality issue. It made people expose their salaries and had studios say, okay, so this is what, I mean, it was a big, big deal.
Yep.
And
I do think that you're right, that'll play a role. I think there's this like narrative that kind of she's like the movie star we deserve kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like somebody who is mature and like smart and like, you know, wants to get in the industry and make a, you know, kind of shake it up and make a difference.
And if this year is going to be referred to in any way as a year of the woman with the type of films that are out this year, she is unquestionably going to be the poster woman for that. Mm-hmm. More so than, you know, Brie Larson or Kate Blanchett. She holds this position that the others really don't. And I don't know. I just, it's such a, it just puts her out really far ahead for me. I don't know. That could all just completely fall and crumble. I totally realize that. But we'll see. All right. I think we can let people off the hook, but as we were talking about earlier with the schedule of awards tsunami that's coming, I'm going to try and get out predictions from the Gold Rush Gang for a lot of these organizations on the website as quick as possible, because obviously we can't have a podcast every other day. I'd love to, but I think that would probably be a little bit too much, so we'll be looking at next Sunday for another one that will encompass everything that's happened in the coming week. But you can always come to awardswatch.com and look at the Gold Rush Gang predictions for the Oscars. Follow us on Twitter at awards_watch. Like us on Facebook and Instagram and wherever you want. And YouTube! The podcasts are on YouTube now, so if that's your preferred way to listen to them, there you go. I want to thank Kenneth and Evan so very much for joining me today in our 2-hour-plus podcast. I'm actually glad we did a long one today. They've been very short recently, and although they're very efficient, I've heard a lot of feedback that people have missed the longer ones, so here we go, because there was so much to talk about this time. So thank you, gentlemen, very much.
Thank you.
All right, everybody. We'll talk to you later.